everybody. I've got Tim with me today, and we are going to be talking about the idea of process reengineering. But before we dive into the questions that I have for you, Tim, can you give everybody a quick introduction?
Sure, Emma. Thanks for having me. I'm the Vice President of Growth at Claimatics. Been in the insurance business about 20 years now, investigating and managing insurance claims all over the globe, and have just had so much fun with it. But yeah, look forward to sharing some ideas with you today.
Wonderful. So to get us started, you have a really great analogy that you use for helping people kind of put this idea of process reengineering into perspective. Can you share that with everybody?
Sure. So I always say that, you know, just like with anything else, you know, building a business is just like building a house, right? So when my wife and I first got married, we built a little 1,000-square-foot house. And then as we, you know, have kids, we add onto the house over time. And so we add on kids' bedrooms, we add on a play area, we maybe remodel a kitchen, we add on an outdoor area. And so over the course of, you know, 10 or 15 or 20 years, you've got this cobbled together thing, right? Well, then Betty comes to me and she says, "Hey, Tim, I want you to design me a 3,000-square-foot house on purpose." Well, the design of our brand new house would always look fundamentally different than this cobbled together thing. And so what happens in business is the same thing happens, because, you know, we grow over time, and with cash flow restrictions and the people that we hire and the types of products and services that we choose to go with and the business processes that we choose to implement at those times, we essentially cobble together this business. But then as we grow over 10 or 15 or 20 years, we look fundamentally different down the road than we did before. But most folks don't stop to think about, how should I redesign my business to be more efficient? But, you know, like I said, going back to the house analogy, obviously we would say, well, if we're going to build a house from scratch, we're going to put the kids' rooms over here and we're going to put them all together and we're going to have this play area probably in a different way. We might add another bathroom, or we might, you know, put something else on a different wall. But there's always changes you would make if you just kind of start with a blank slate. And so that's at least the idea, you know, from a design thinking perspective of just, let's just draw it out on paper from an ideal perspective. And then we can say, okay, here's the ideal. Here's our current reality. And now that we have those two endpoints, we can start to look at what is the process to get us closer to that goal. And I always say the nice thing about business is, you know, we don't have to make it perfect, right? We're all fundamentally flawed, but every step we take in that direction fundamentally improves business efficiency, fundamentally improves profitability, fundamentally improves, you know, both customer engagement, employee engagement, any one of a number of other really important benefits. And so it's an important journey to take, and it's an important concept to have that's always, you know, kind of in the back of your mind as your business is growing.
Great. Thank you. Anybody who knows me knows I'm like the number one fan of analogies because I think it helps break things down in a really universal way. So thank you for sharing that. When we take a look at, you know, you mentioned this idea of how drastically this can change the way that your business is operating. Can you share a little bit more about the idea of kind of why you think that this idea of process redesign is so critical for businesses as they continue to grow?
Yeah, well, there's just a lot of things that happens, right? So, for example, you know, if you have 50 or 60 employees, or you have 150 employees, there's some fundamentally different decisions that you can make at that size and scope that are, you know, can be really important from a financial perspective. So, for example, you know, most small businesses, when they start out, they might go with like a professional employer organization model or something like that. But then as you get bigger, just like with insurance, you know, once we get to a level of financial security, we can choose to self-insure ourselves. So we can raise our deductibles from $250 with our auto to maybe $1,000, which brings down our premium pretty significantly. And, you know, a lot of times, like what we did, you know, probably a decade ago, we went from a 100, 300 insurance policy to a 250, 500 policy, but we moved our deductible up. So we actually got better insurance for less money, but that also allowed us to buy $1 million umbrella liability policy. So we've got a lot more coverage, but we're taking a little bit extra risk on ourselves for that first $1,000. The same thing happens in bigger business. So you can choose to self-insure some of your health insurance options, some of your other insurance costs. And a lot of times, I mean, like especially health insurance, I mean, that's the number two or number three cost to a business. And so if you can save 20 or 30% of your health insurance, you know, line item, I mean, that's fundamentally allows you to reinvest back into the business. And so size is important. Size and scope becomes important because, again, there's fundamental decisions that you make at different points in your journey. In the technology world, we say that every time you double revenue, you basically have to redesign your business. And so when you think about, you know, the easy example is, you know, back in the day, we used to FedEx documents back and forth to each other, right? And so we'd sign documents, put them in FedEx, send them off. Well, you know, it first starts out, it's a couple $100 a month. It's not a big deal. Well, if your business is growing, then all of a sudden, 2 or 3 years later, now your FedEx line item is $4,000 a month. But people don't necessarily ever think about, well, man, there's actually now some software available that might be, say, $2,000 in cost, but that would totally nullify the rest of that deal. So it didn't make sense when we were spending $300 a month on it, but now that we're spending $4,000 a month on it, it becomes justifiable, right? So there's just different things that you can do at different points in time that you've just got to be aware of. But the problem is, most of us in business, we only know what we know, right? And so we haven't necessarily grown a business from $3 million to $3 billion. And so if we're at $3 million and we've become six, it's the first time we've ever been there. So we don't know what we're doing. And so we either have two options. We just sort of figure it out on our own, which is what a lot of people do, or we can actually go get some wise counsel for some people that have already been there and done that. But just like any other sports that, you know, activity, the first time I do something, I'm not going to be very good at it. But the 20th time I do it, I'm going to be really, really good at it, right? So it's just one of those things. It's just an experiential piece over time.
I think that's a really good way when you were talking about that FedEx example. Process and efficiency can sneak up on you. And if you're not spending a lot of time thinking about it and focusing on it, like all of us in this process world are, you might not realize how much money you're leaving on the table by having an outdated process or having some of these repeatable tasks that you could be automating in some form or fashion. You using that technology, you're leaving an opportunity on the table that, to your point, you might not even realize is there. When we take a look at this idea of process redesign, and we've talked about the idea of technology and these two coming together, from your perspective, why do you think this idea of process redesign is so critical to kind of the larger umbrella of digital transformation?
No, that's a really good question. And I think I'll start with a preface and then we'll move into your question. So what I'll tell you from a management consulting perspective, and of course, everybody's always highly interested in financials and the why for them. So what you understand from a management consulting perspective is every single business, I can walk into 100 random businesses today, do a 3 to 5 year review of their financials with their owner and show them 2 to 7% of either gross revenue or SG&A that they are letting slip through their fingers. And so there's fundamental profit loss in every single business because of this inefficiency that we talk about as it creeps in over time. And so the bigger you get, the bigger this inefficiency becomes. So that's the why. That's why you even want to think about this. Why? That's why it's important. To answer your question on, you know, what are the elements of it? It's important to think about because, you know, like if you start a small little, you know, lawn business and you go mow somebody's lawn and say, hey, I just got done with your lawn, and you go up to the door and you knock on it, you say, just finished, you know, come take a look at it, make sure it's cool, and then you can pay me. It's very, very simple. But then if all of a sudden you're mowing 150 lawns, well, now you're either invoicing people, having to wait on payments, and then you get into a whole account receivable issue. And so there's just a lot of things that as you grow become inefficient as a normal course of business. And so that's why you've always got to be aware of not only technological opportunities, but, you know, even some just basic business process redesign pieces of once I hit a certain size and scope, I've got to segregate out duties differently, right? I mean, for example, the classic story in small business is Sally the bookkeeper is also Sally the payroll clerk, is also Sally the administrative assistant, is also the HR person, is also the et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Well, as you grow, she's obviously not going to be able to do all of that forever. And so then you have to say, well, okay, we need her to just do payroll. We need another person to do AR. We need another person to do AP. We need another person to do, you know, HR. And so you start to segregate out those duties over time. And not to mention that also as you grow, the level of expertise that you need in those roles becomes a lot more important. And so Sally, the bookkeeper, while it was great when you were a little $500,000 business, you know, is not a full-blown HR expert when you have 50 or 60 employees that you've got to manage that can actually keep track of what all is going on and make sure you're in compliance. So again, you know, when you're really, really small, again, the liability is fairly limited, but as you grow, the liability becomes larger. And there's just some fundamental changes that need to take place as well. And so being aware of those, and understanding how to plan and, you know, have those built into your roadmap. That way, as soon as you reach certain milestones, you can start to incorporate those into your business. Just make the transition, you know, easier for everybody. Because one of the big issues we talk about a lot with digital transformation is the employee adjustment to it, right? We're now having to change how Sally had to do something forever. Well, so is it better for us to tell Sally 6 months in advance, hey, this is going to be coming down the road. Here's what's going to change. Here's what you're going to need you to do. Here's a training you're going to get, blah, 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 and ease her into it, or come to her one day and say, Sally, stop what you're doing to do today and do this. And so there's just a lot of thought and work that needs to go into the preparation of that in order to make a successful transformation.
And I think the thing that you brought up at the beginning of, you know, some of those shifts that need to happen in your process as you grow, there are things that you can do to improve your business operation without necessarily bringing in technology. And then hopefully you can couple this process redesign and the technology to really create this like amazing firework show of efficiency, because you've taken the time to look at the process redesign on the front end, make the changes that you need to, maybe eliminate processes or change, you know, like you were mentioning, fundamentally how you're doing those, and then bring technology into aiding being even more efficient on top of it. So I think that these two ideas, you know, from Naviant's perspective, we talk about these two ideas side by side all the time. So I really appreciate you sitting down and sharing your thoughts on this with me. Again, going back to that analogy, I think it's really great to break it down in a way that's universal to everybody. So thank you for your time today, Tim, and for joining us today, everybody. If you're interested in learning more about, you know, the topics that we talked today about, make sure you jump on over to Tim's LinkedIn and connect with him there. I'm sure he'd be more than happy to have a conversation with you. But thanks for joining us, everybody, and have a great day.
Thank you, guys.